That's Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
We're not done in worship this morning. That's something you can be familiar with. You can bet your bottom dollar on that. Because the Lord ain't done with that song. But if you could, just to give an introductory, to be able to exhort, to be able to bring forth something great, turn with me to Deuteronomy, the 30th chapter. And turning to Deuteronomy, the 30th chapter, starting at the 15th verse. Coming out of the New King James Version, the scripture says, "See, I have set before you today life and good, death and evil, in that I command you today to love the Lord your God, to walk in his ways, and to keep his commandments, his statutes and his judgments, that you may live and multiply. And the Lord your God will bless you in all the land which you go to possess." Which you go to possess. There's an attempt there. There's a command there. He says, "In that I command you today to love your God." But I want you to understand something. He says, "I set before you." Anytime you have more than one option, you now have a choice. I set before you good and evil. I set before you life. Or death. If I slide down to the 19th verse, it says, "I call heaven and earth as witnesses today against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life, that both you and your descendants may live." I want you to understand today, in order to have favor, you got to be alive. And the Lord was speaking to me.
Hold that for a minute. You can go on.
Good job, good job. Don't hold it up, just hold it. The Lord was speaking to me, and he kept saying that people have abandoned his favor, looking for the ramifications of death. And I want you to understand, as you kind of just think back over your week, how many instances of death that were glorified? How many times you've heard of something that was dead be glorified, whether it be a physical death or a spiritual death. And I mean that in saying, if you watch the news, you see a person that may have been shot, or they give a murder count, or they're talking about somebody popular that died. But how often is it that we hear somebody talking about their love of the Lord, but they really don't mean it? That they're going to make a change. But it's just smoke and mirrors. How often is it that we hear somebody want to speak a word of faith because they're faking it until they make it? They're faking it until they believe it. See, the Lord today says, choose life. Because if you really don't understand what life is, you've missed it. So,
Love you.
So, in loving the Lord and understanding that that love is going to add to your life, that it is the very substance of what life is, you can now live. But you can live without harm. You can live without curses. You can live without the sickness. You can live not being afraid to die. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we just bless you today because you are life. You are the source and the substance. You are everything that we need. And Father, we just call you into the midst of us right now, that you would take over this place, that you would teach, that you would speak, that you would heal, that you would edify, you would encourage, you would bring joy, because nothing exists without you. So Father, in the name of Jesus, we speak life into this place. We speak life into the dead places in our lives, to the dead places in our minds, yes, the dead places in our community, yes, the dead places in our finances, yes, the dead places in our family. Yes. We speak life.
Yes.
And life more abundant.
Yes.
For Jesus, that is your promise.
Yes.
And we stand on it.
Yes.
We stand on your promise of health and healing. We stand on your promise, yes, of freedom. We,
yes,
stand on your promise of salvation.
Yes.
We stand on your promise that you would forgive us.
Yes.
So today, Lord, we live by forgiving ourselves.
Yes. Yes.
We live by forgiving them.
Yes.
We live, we move, and we have our being through you. So have your way in this place. Allow your spirit to flow like never before. We place a demand and an expectation upon you to not only teach, but to change lives today. We pray for our children today in all that they do, in all that they think, in all that they want to do. Father, we pray right now grace and mercy over them right,
yes,
now in the name of Jesus. We pray empowerment over them right now in the name of Jesus, that they would regain the thoughts of their mind.
Yes.
That they would have successful role models and mentors and parents that would speak godly wisdom into their lives. And that they would obey their mothers and fathers so that they may live long. It is your promise. It is your word. And you always deliver on it.
Yes.
So, Father, in the name of Jesus, just touch these children right now. All anxiousness,
yes,
all weary, all doubt, all frustration, Right now, in the name of Jesus, we release that on them. Right now, in the name of Jesus. We bind that spirit right now in the name of Jesus. And we call forth the power and the love of the Almighty God to saturate these children.
Yes.
In a new way. Give them what they need and not necessarily what they want.
Yes.
We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I'm about it back now. Thank you, sir. Go have a seat. I know you wrinkled my shirt up. I'll pretty well pass before a minute. You wrinkled my shirt up, man. If I didn't say good morning to you, good morning to you. I'm going to do something a little differently today. And if you could, turn with me to Genesis, the second chapter. I want to go there, but I can't go there. And we'll start at the 7th verse. This is information that's going to take you to another level. You need the Bible? And though you know what you know, I don't think you really know what you thought you knew. I want you to understand we got to be patient for the children and with the children, because if we don't teach them right now, what do they have to fall back on? Genesis 2 and 7 for me.
Then the Lord God took some soil from the ground and formed a man out of it. He breathed life-giving breath into his nostrils, and man began to live.
Okay, so from the beginning of time, God created the heavens and the earth, and he did all the animals, and it was something missing. Because he didn't have nobody to tend to all that he created. So he grabbed a little dirt, kind of balled it up a little bit, and he blew into it. And boom, there's man. But I want you to understand something. As he blew into him, man came alive. I hope y'all that got an ear to hear this understand where I'm going. Because if indeed we're dealing with life, we understand that as long as we have breath in our body, we are alive. Otherwise, we return back to the dirt. But the only one that gives breath is he who did it the first time. So to be alive is to carry the breath of God. And if indeed carrying the breath of God holds any weight in our lives, it means the very essence of who we are is old to him.
It's what?
It's old to him. Why am I going there? Well, a lot of times we are told that life is a three-part journey. It's the past, it's the present, it is the future. When mama carrying you in the womb, life is being formed in her belly. Life is maturing in her belly. Baby being birthed, he now has a time frame to become useful, to become relevant, to become significant. But when he dies, at his funeral, they tell a eulogy of what? How useful he was to them. Okay? I got Genesis 2, and I got man's interpretation. Spiritual and natural. Natural says, once the breath leaves a man's body, the only thing useful to him at that point in time is the dirt. But what has he done? What legacy has he left? What significance? What imprint did God use in the breath that he gave him to put God's stamp on the world? Ooh, that's a heavy thought. Because when I look back at my life, I don't feel like I did enough. If I was to go today and they gave my eulogy, they have a whole lot of nice stuff to say about me and how I did for them. But how much stuff could they run down to him? See, if I trip off of Deuteronomy 30, and he said, I call the heavens in as a witness against you. You're now on jury. You're now sitting on trial, and heaven is your jury. I call the heavens in to witness against you. What choice did you make during the time that you had breath? What did you do with the very thing that God gave to you that nobody, no man, no demon in hell could take away? Did you value the very first gift God gave to the world? The very first gift God gave to mankind. Do you value it? Why is that important? In a world full of death, in a city that's riddled with death, in relationships that harbor death. See, death is nothing more than where God ain't present no more. Where the gift of God is not wanted. Where the choice has been denied. I ain't left y'all. I know. Y'all sitting here looking at me like, oh man, I don't have a clue what you're talking about. Give me that. I got you. Because I got some good notes, man. When we view our lives, it's normally how much we got, how others see us, what we've done for somebody else, and what else? When you look at your life, what else? Anything else? give me some. Come on. This is participation sport.
How you live your life.
How you live your life. Okay. But how do you live your life?
Everyone.
Okay. When I look at my life, and I look at some a good life, and this is how I used to look at things. It was how easy things came to me. Because when you see somebody else living beyond where you are at this point in time, it looks easy. When I look at Donald Trump and all his money and that big old carpet he got on his head and that crazy cheap ball cap that he always wearing and all these millions and millions and millions of dollars that he has, it looks easy. When I was little, I looked at the preacher and always had something to say about him. But he was standing out front. He had his suit. He had his Cadillac. He kept his money. He kept a lot. But it looked easy. He was living. He's living. When I look at the TV shows and I see the lifestyles of the people, they were living. Now let me take you old heads back a little touch. Y'all remember Good Times? Mm-hmm. Was JJ and them living or was they surviving?
Oh. They were surviving, but they still had their family together. So, you know.
But what image did you take while you were watching the show?
That they were poor. They were needy.
Put it this way. Did you want to be JJ now?
No.
Remember Sanford and Son?
Yeah.
You do. You sit back and you watch Fred Sanford call everybody a big dummy. But how many of us really wanted to be Fred Sanford? Fred Sanford wasn't living like we thought he should live. Hey, Ben. I'm gonna give you another black TV show. Remember What's Happening with Raj and Dee? How many of us really wanted to live like that? Single parent home. Mama working all day, all night. Big brother and little sister in the house fending for each other and just out having fun without a care in the world, but you ain't had nothing. Is that an image of living? Alright. Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. How many wanted to be the Fresh Prince? How many wanted to have somebody wait on your hand and foot? Get what you want, how you want, when you want, with the snap of your finger. Living is the easiness of life. Whatever I ain't gotta work for, I'm gonna think it's easy. I'm gonna think it's living. Cause I'm gonna look at it and say, I can sit in their shoes. I can do that. I want that. But I want you to catch something. In order to be great at something, in order to live at something, you gotta do it a little while. You gotta build up a little endurance. See, if I wanna be a runner, I gotta practice running, don't I? Mm-hmm. But if I wanna be alive, that means I gotta practice living. Not the living of what my eyes see, not the, sit up. Ain't no sleeping today. Not the living of what easiness is in life. Because if indeed you've been given the word of God, and the word of God says that when God breathed life into the dirt, he came alive. It didn't say that his life was going to be easy. It didn't say that his life was going to be appealing. See, God needed somebody to tend to the world. Ooh, big way. Can you run the world? Halftime, I can't run my own house. Run the world? Adam had big weight on his shoulders. Wasn't nobody else there to do it. So he messed up. It was messed up. Nobody else could cover it up. He had to value the breath of life. He had to value the fact that God had just told him, dude, you was dirt about 20 seconds ago. You were blowing in the wind about 20 seconds ago. That horse was urinating on you about 20 seconds ago. The birds were stomping on your head about 20 seconds ago. How much do you value yourself now? Do you value who you are? The fact that God thought enough of you just to get you up this morning because you can. Wait a minute, we just got to talking about practicing and exercising, doing it over and over and over again. The problem being, we have a problem with life because we ain't started living it yet. Y'all don't believe me? Here, I'm gonna tell you what we have to say, and I'm gonna slide on to another scripture. Because I told you about that past, present, and future. But I want you to hear what Webster got to say. Because Webster is hilarious to me. Webster's dictionary says, the way or manner of living. A period or duration of usefulness or popularity of something. One providing interest or vigor. So wait a minute, the only purpose of me existing is to be interesting, entertaining to somebody else. But wait a minute, this is what we've done all of our lives. We call it living, but what we're doing is we playing the fool for somebody else. Wake up. We're playing the fool for somebody. And in the midst of playing the fool for somebody, what we've come into doing is, it's become our routine. Wait a minute. Friend Sanford. Good times. What's happening? They were entertainment. And we styled our lives behind it. Fresh Prince of Bel-Air was entertainment, but guess what we attempted to do? We copycatted that lifestyle. How can we say we're living life when we're imitating entertainment? I ain't giving you my definition, I'm giving you Webster. This is what the educated people didn't say. You know, the people that got the ED, PhD, MD, MS, LMNOP behind their name, that been in school all their life, and dictate how you entertain them. Oh. Oh. There was one other definition that threw me under the bus a little bit because it was the same word as a definition. The period of time when a person is alive. But if I'm alive, that's my life, ain't it? But watch this. Alive to them is, how do I entertain them? How am I interesting and useful to them? This is what they came up with. So I went to alive, because, you know, I just had to be there. And all of a sudden, I saw the same thing as I saw as life, but I saw one other definition. The ability to grow and change. So if I'm alive, that means that I have an ability. An ability is something that I have to choose to pursue. It's something I have to choose to possess. Deuteronomy 30. I believe it's 15. Somebody read that for me.
So 30:15.
Mm-hmm.
Today I'm giving you a choice between good and evil, between life and death.
Keep going.
If you obey the commands of the Lord your God, which I give you today, if you love him, obey him, keep all his laws, then you will prosper, become a nation of many people. The Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are about to occupy.
Occupy means to possess. Occupy means that, guess what? I now choose to go. To occupy means that I'm going into something and I'm planning to stay there. But watch this. If I'm just the entertainment, I want you to think back in the days of King Arthur. King Arthur had his important people and he had his court jester. In King Arthur's court, his court could stay with him at all points in time. But when he needed a good laugh, he called in his jester. The jester never had the right to occupy or possess what King Arthur had. And watch this. When the jester didn't make King Arthur laugh, off with his head. That was his life. His usefulness to them. See, we get into a place of our life where we become so useful to other people that we ain't being used by him because we left him out. Because guess what we did? We made him our entertainment for the moment to make us feel a little better. To put a smile on our face. Rub my head, God. Come on, Jesus. Say something nice to me. And when you got through with him, his lifespan was done for that season in your life. Because once you got back on your useful path of being useful to them, left him out. Off with your head. Why? We stop choosing to live and exercise our right to live because we only saw ourselves in a limited space, a usefulness for that time. Think about it. Come on, it's a space between my ears that they say is a brain. And I have the ability to occupy my thoughts. Right? But if I don't occupy my thoughts with the very breath of God, I'm dead. Think about that. In Deuteronomy 30, I think that's 18, tells me, hey, if you obey the Lord thy God, He will prosper your hands even in the land that you go to occupy or possess. Following God, because God is really the essence of my life in the first place. But when I turn from my essence of who I really am to recreate myself to be something that they want me to be, I stop breathing. You can't occupy, but you ain't alive to keep it. You cannot occupy what you're not alive to keep. I keep going back to this breath of God because this is a prayer point. If you're serious about the breath of God and what it holds in your life, if it created you to be alive, why won't I ask for the breath of God in all the things that are dead around me? Leave them alone. Don't pay them no more mind. Why won't I ask for the breath of God in everything dead around me? Think about it. We were talking about the winds of change. Put your hand in front of your nose and tell me that ain't wind. From one breath to the next, something different happened. Whether you admit it or not. Whether you embrace it or not. Watch this. Whether you value it or not. There's so many things in a day that'll get us twisted up. And I still ain't gave you the biblical definition. Because I'm going to give it to you, but I just want you to catch this. There's so many things that get us twisted up that really choke the spiritual life out of us. Somebody turn to Luke 12. Everybody turn to Luke 12. I ain't read it, but make sure y'all agree. Somebody read me Luke 12:15.
And he said unto them, take heed and beware of covetousness of a man's life. Consider not in the abundance of the things which he possesseth. Keep going.
Might give me a different version.
Then he said to them, watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions.
So watch this. He's giving a warning to not make a choice of worrying about what you got. Somebody read me 16.
Read what?
Verse 16.
Then Jesus told them this parable. There was once a rich man who had land which bore good crops. He began to think to himself, I don't have a place to keep all my crops. What can I do? This is what I'll do, he said to himself. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones where I will store the grain and all of my other goods. Then I will say to myself, lucky man, you have all these good things you need for many years. Take life easy, eat, drink, and enjoy yourself. But God said to him, you fool, this very night, you will have to give up your life. Then who will get all these things that you kept for yourself?
Oh, you stop right there. Who got something out of that? Wait a minute, I'm trying to get all this stuff to appeal to other people. But Jesus said, you're a fool if that's what you want. Because watch this, if you live your life worrying about what you gonna get, how you gonna get it, how you gonna show it off to the next person, how they gonna receive what it is that you got that don't belong to them, and whether or not they gonna like you. Guess what you just did? You took Adam at the beginning of time and you just choked him. But you did it to yourself in the spirit. It ain't living. How is it that we say we want to be more like Jesus? We want to be shaped and molded in the image of Jesus. But then we model ourselves after the very people he rebuked. This is what we've modeled our lives behind. Because he was kind of like that good time story. He was a good dude and he did some great things. But then nobody won't be like him. Didn't nobody want to be like Kid Dynamite? Why? Because he walked around in funny clothes. He had a good heart. He clowned some folks in his time. He was popular among men. But didn't nobody want to be like him? That wasn't living. He did everything according to the very breath that his father gave him. He wouldn't speak out a breath that was against what his father gave him. He wouldn't think out of a breath of anything that his father did not give him. He was not going to allow somebody to steal, kill, and destroy his life. Turn to John 10. Children, read me verse 10 in chapter 10. We'll read.
The robber comes only to steal and to kill and to destroy. I came so they might have life and a grateful life.
Ah! Somebody else give me that in a different version.
A thief cometh not, but to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly.
They might have life more abundantly. That they might have life more abundantly. Wait a minute. We're talking about Jesus, the dude that didn't nobody really want to be like. The dude that didn't force nobody to do nothing. Wait a minute, hold on. Then I got the devil over here, who don't force nobody to do nothing either. You can't have a choice unless you got two options. something. Jesus is saying, watch this. When you choose to worry about your possessions, when you choose to worry about how they feel about you, when you choose to sit back and become their entertainment, he then has the right to kill, steal, and destroy. Deuteronomy 30 tells me that I have the choice between good in life, curses in death. I'm setting up something when I make a choice. See, we don't choose to live more times than not. What we choose to do is become a time frame in somebody's life. If indeed we look at how God's gonna have this, the good book in heaven, with all our names written in it, when it's time to go in, if this is a novel, guess what? That space that we carved out for ourselves is nothing more than a footnote. It's a footnote. Somebody put A1 behind it and said, good thing. Check mark. We acknowledge the fact you did it, so what? Keep moving. How often and how many times are we going to just be a footnote when he thinks so much highly of us? See, I'm trying to get a point across here as I'm pushing life on you. Because a footnote ain't animated. How many times have we read a book and seen the footnote, but never went to go look it up? How many times have we read the Bible and seen italic A, italic B, italic 1, 2, 3, and never went to look it up? It was insignificant. Watch this. The way that we've lived our lives as entertainment to other people, trying to get them to be satisfied with us. All of this is a footnote. So guess what? You start thinking that you're holding some significance in their life, and they write you off like a piece of toilet paper. You all know what we do to toilet paper after we're done with it. That's what you are when you choose to be their entertainment. Because when that episode is over, I'm looking for the next one. Stop being somebody's episode. Write your novel with God. Strong's Dictionary. Life is to live the experience of God's gift. Huh? What does that mean? How can I say that I know God, that I live and breathe everything that God is, when I've yet to accept the gift of God? When I've yet to experience, watch this, breathing with God. That is the most intimate stage of sensitivity you can have with anyone. In order to check to see if somebody's alive, what's the first thing you do? Do you go check their pulse, or do you see if they breathe? See, we'll pray to God, I want to see what you see. I want to hear what you hear. I want to feel what you feel. But we forgot the most basic thing. How can two walk together unless they agree? If I'm trying to choke myself while he trying to resuscitate me, is it going to work? My God. I want you to really think about that. I want to walk with God, but I want to be their puppet. I want to serve God, but I want to be their entertainment. I want to understand God, but my motives, my ideas, my purpose in living ain't to get closer. It's to be seen. I want to be significant. Hey, you. Hey, you. And a one. And a two. Am I making you laugh yet? Yay! And after you stop laughing, after they are stopped being amused, you go back to being the same turd that you were to them before. But God's sitting there like, why are you doing jumping jacks? Why are you doing flips? To be seen by them. To be heard by them. Why are you doing all of that? Why won't you just breathe with me? See, when you experience God, you now exist in places that you didn't exist before. You now have a favor, you now have doors open to you, you now have resources that are applied to you. It ain't even something that you went to go get yet. They already slapped on your name, because guess what? In order to get the heartbeat of God, you gotta be breathing in time with Him. You don't breathe without your heart going, and every time the heart contracts, it lets go, you breathe. Can you hear the heartbeat of God if you ain't in timing? You ain't in timing. You ain't in timing. This is what you're doing. Hey, you! And watch this. If I run up and down the steps 5 times, am I breathing the same? You're now worn out. You're now tired. You're now bewildered. But God was the same yesterday, today, and forever. Which means that His breath never stopped. It never changed rhythm. Mm-mm. Somebody help me there. If it didn't change rhythm, but you did, because you wearing yourself out. Hey, look at me! Look at me! Yay! God speaks in a small, still voice. But when He gotta yell at you, it's probably because you screaming like a little kid trying to get some attention in the midst of your temper tantrum. Say, somebody keep me alive. Somebody make my dream alive. Somebody make my understanding alive. You went to the wrong source. Steal, kill, and destroy life, and life more abundantly. More abundantly means it's more than what I can handle. I just gotta understand that. I gotta practice this side of my life. I've been practicing this too long. This is so interesting to me because I went to Vines. I'm still on life. I ain't went no further than life. Next week, be a whole different thing. But you gotta understand living first. Life is contingent upon continuing. Watch this. If I got their attention, hey, see me. Once I got their attention, now what? You ain't even got a plan for that far. You wanted to stop. Your life just ended. You just gave your life away. Because you wanted to stop. Continuing. It's contingent upon continuing. Getting to the next level. The next dominion. the next place, the next heartbeat, the next breath of God, the next move of God, the next blessing of God, the next flow, overflow of anointing. See, we'll get satisfied and we won't stop. Watch this. You can't worship while you dead. Because once you get to the level that you wanted to get to, you'll stop. I want you to catch the secondary part of this definition. It is the sustaining breath of God. Something that sustains you, takes you beyond where you can go, or keeps you in a place that you don't want to stay. So when I'm struggling, when I'm lonely, when I'm sitting back and I'm in pain, I need something to sustain me. Because those are the times that we just want to die. Well, we felt like the situation didn't already kill us. How many times in our lives have we, that's killing me! Chester, God, I can hear your heartbeat. When you hear something consistent, it tends to soothe you. It will soothe you to a place of sustaining you where you want to take off and run like hell. Oh, well, if I'm always panicking, if I'm always tripping out, if I'm always worrying, if I'm always in need of attention, what was I seeking? What choice was I making? I need my mama to talk to me. Well, what if mama in a worse situation than you? I need my friends to say something nice to me. What if they're in the same situation as you? I just need somebody to be around me. I just need to talk to somebody. What if they can't understand what it is that you gotta say? If you breathe the breath of life in you, who do you think you're taking out of you? Why won't you go back to the very one that gave you the first gift? That's been blessing you from day one. But instead, guess what we do? We start hitting that old court jester again. We want to make them laugh. We want to make them feel good. We want to get some attention the way that we know how. But we ain't got a plan beyond getting that attention. Because all we wanted was to satisfy that need. Once we achieve the riches of life, we ain't got a plan beyond that. Because we satisfied the need. Once we sit back and we get a position somewhere, we ain't desiring too much more because we ain't got a plan for what we're supposed to do in that position. We just coveted it. It was just a desire. It ain't as if you said, I want this position because I can do so much better. Because the Lord has blessed me to do so much better. The Lord will make room for me to do so much better. See, I'm choosing to live because guess what? How can I speak life over myself when I'm killing the one that God put in that place? How can I speak life to somebody else when I'm choking myself out? Life is a continual, consistent circle. Now, I want you to catch this, because this one, it blew me away. And I'm going to close with a scripture beyond that. But life ceases when God stops breathing. When I'm out of breath in life, or I'm out of breath in the spirit realm, because when you get out of breath, you get a little tired. You get a little weary. You get a little desperate. You get real anxious. We start grabbing for straws, but never grabbing for the breath of God. Lord, breathe on me. How about it? Breathe in my situation. Breathe in my area. I'll catch you. If I'm that desperate for God, I don't care if he just... Negro, please. I don't get that. And it might not make a whole lot of sense right now. But you got to break down God to his simplicity. We done made God so extravagant that we're afraid to approach him. We're afraid to experience God. We're afraid to experience Holy Spirit. We're afraid to experience Jesus. Why? They're the same person. Want to know why we're afraid? Because we're afraid to live. We're afraid of the sustaining period. Because the sustaining period says that I gotta stay there. I gotta go through something. I gotta deal with something. I gotta trust you. I gotta no longer take, and give what I want to give. I got to get into a straight up mutual exchange with you. See, to experience God, that means I have to mutually exchange some things. I got to give some stuff up as I get some stuff. But many times, we don't want to sit in that place because it's a whole lot of stuff that Jesus was talking about, that greed, that covetousness, that you're a fool. And what we're really doing in our spirit is, I can't breathe. I can't breathe. And God said, take your hand off your neck. Stop choking yourself. Stop choking your blessing. Stop choking your deliverance. Stop choking your healing. Stop choking your prosperity. Stop choking out your favor. My God. I'm going to close with this. Turn to Psalms 118. Somebody read me 7th verse out of that.
It is the Lord who helps me, and I will see my enemies defeated.
Oh! It is the Lord who helps me. Even when I'm the one that got my hand around my throat. It is the Lord who helps me. When I ain't got a dime in my pocket, it is the Lord who helps me. When I'm gasping for air, when I'm in need of him. And I don't know how to get there. It's the Lord that helps me when I need an understanding of something, but don't even know how to seek out the understanding. It's the Lord that helps me. See, the problem being, you can't do it. So often, you got your hands on it. You trying to make something happen. You doing all the animated things to make them see you and him see you. But if you understand, it's the Lord that helps you. When you gasping for air, it's his touch that go that regulates things. It's his breath that gives you the increase and the overflow. It's his breath that swings the pendulum for changing your life. It's him that started it. It's him that's going to finish it. So why in the world are we so busy trying to construct our lives? It is the Lord who helps me when I ain't got a message and I need one bad. It's the Lord that helps me when I'm sitting in the middle of the night trying to figure out what to pray but don't want to. It's the Lord that helps me to get up and be nice to people even though I can't stand their guts. See, if you won't embrace the helper, catch that in the spirit, how can the helper give you the breath of life? See, once upon a time, Jesus said, I will send a helper, which is yet another gift, to live, according to Vine's Dictionary, says that I live experiencing God's gift. I'm experiencing Holy Spirit, my helper. Now I'm living. Now I'm living. Because Holy Spirit is going to say, this is how it should be done. This is the way it needs to go. The Holy Spirit will say, turn left, don't go right. Holy Spirit will say, shut up. Holy Spirit is going to tell you, live. Well, you want your Holy Spirit talk? Watch this. Somebody read me the 17th verse out of that scripture. David said it, but I want you to understand who made him proclaim it over his life.
The 17th verse 118.
Mm-hmm.
I will not die but live and will proclaim what the Lord has done.
Say it again.
I will not die but live and will proclaim what the Lord has done.
Read it like you mean it.
I will not die but live and will proclaim what the Lord has done.
Hold on, stop. I want you to think about what David is dealing with, because David's talking about his trials and his tribulations in this. But it was his helper who was of the Lord that made him declare this over his life. It wasn't that he was, I'm just back gonna die, I'm gonna live. No. Because if I'm proclaiming the works of the Lord, I got some attitude behind that. It's some stank on my voice. Wait a minute. You're talking about a man that was a man of war, that constantly had his life in jeopardy. Because of the Lord who helped him. He wasn't afraid of death. He wasn't afraid of the battles that he was going to have to walk into. He wasn't afraid of sustaining periods. Why? Somebody tell me why. I want you to really think about why. Think about why he was not afraid of death. Think about why he was able to proclaim this over his life and say it with confidence. Wait a minute, we the people that go through the motions and that fake it till they make it. But David wasn't faking it till he made it, because he made it. As we think about why, it was the promise of God. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Forsake means that I turn my back on you when you can't get there. Forsake means I forgot about you. I will not leave you nor forsake you. I ain't forgetting about you, even though they did. I'm not gonna leave you alone just because you put a limit on your life. I'm not gonna forget about you because you only wanted to be the court jester, the class clown. Not gonna forget about you. Not only am I not gonna forget about you, I'm still gonna be there when you need my gift. I'm just waiting on you to come and experience my gift. And when you are at a place where you're prepared and you truly, willingly made a choice between the killing, the stealing, and the destroying, and the life more abundantly, or as Deuteronomy put it, death and curses, good and life. When you've made that choice, you can with confidence say, I shall not die. I shall not die. When in your mind, you say, you hear that little voice say, you need somebody. You can yell at it, I shall not die. What you telling him that for? Because when you accept that thought, you start choking yourself. And you got off in your feelings, you got all mad because somebody treated you and rubbed you the wrong way, said a little something about you. You got a choice now. They may not understand it, but guess what? You ain't there to talk their language. You ain't living for them. Talk his language. Speak the word. I shall not die. I choose life. And all of a sudden, because with confidence and faith that's now bubbling up on the inside of you, you gonna get an overwhelming help. Listen to that fool talking about they shouldn't die. They always talking something off the wall. Well, it wasn't meant for them to understand in the first place. You ain't talking to them. You talking to the one that gave you breath. You're talking to the gift of God. Hold on. Deuteronomy 30 and 15 told me. I'm sorry. Was it 15? 19. It told me that heaven and the angels are standing witness to see what my choice is. If I stand in a courtroom full of Chinese folks and I'm talking Swahili, I'm speaking Ebonics. They don't understand that language very well, huh? So are they gonna pay a whole lot of attention? But if I speak fluent Chinese to them. Oh, really? That's how you feel about it? So my question to you is this. How can you speak to the witnesses and the hosts in heaven if you ain't speaking in a heavenly fashion? Help them, Holy Spirit. The breath of God is the word of God. So if even in the midst of me needing sustaining, I'm now speaking something that I ain't giving you no long elaborate thing. I gave you something to declare over your life. That is the word of God. I shall live and not die. And by saying it out loud, I've already proclaimed what the good Lord has done for me. And you want to know how the world knows? I'm still breathing. I'm still here. I still got an opportunity to change and to grow. I still got an opportunity to experience Holy Spirit. I still have an opportunity to get closer to God. I still have an opportunity. Because to have something in abundance means I now have several choices. Oh. See, I get to live my life more abundantly. I got more choices than the one that backed me into the corner. Oh, so the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, that life was really a good life. Only if it translates to the spirit realm. If I got the choice to continue loving on you, even though you don't love yourself. If I got the choice to continue pouring into you when you reject everything that's given to you. If I got the choice to sit back and sow more into you because you don't understand what it means to be sowed into. If I got the choice to teach you how to open your hands because you don't know how to receive. Ooh, watch this. If I got the choice to walk your butt around a park so that your lungs could get in shape so that you can breathe with God better. So be it. Mm-hmm. So be it. I got choices now. See, over here, I only got one choice. If I do this, this is the only result that I can really see in this. And that should be the way it is. See, in our minds, living is, everything is cut and dry. Get some cake mix, some eggs, some milk, some oil. Butter the pan, mix it up, turn the heat on to 350, and leave it there for 30 to 45 minutes, and you got cake. Right? But when the gas gone, can you still make that cake? Do you still have the option of making that cake? Still not the same ingredient. Yeah, you do. See, when you're living life more abundantly, you might have a new wave of it that's gonna cook that same cake. Well, if I ain't mistaken, my Bible tells me that they were cooking cakes or baking cakes over hot rocks back in the day. They was barbecuing them. Oh, wait a minute. It might not be the same as the one-way result. But I got options. I get an opportunity to find something new and new cases. So guess what? I use my new wave of it to bake a cake. All of a sudden now I got more options to use it because I'm going to explore it more. Well, wait a minute. If the Holy Spirit is now giving me more options, I'm going to explore and experience Him more. My God. And it's funny because if these other options get you to a place of, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. You begin to proclaim what the Lord has done, even more and even louder. But the reason our mouths are shut is because we won't experience life. Close of this scripture is self-explanatory. Somebody turn to Acts, the 17th chapter. Somebody read me 24 through
28.
God, who made the world and everything in it, is the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples made by human hands. Nor does he need anything that we can supply by working for him, since it is he himself who gives life and breath and everything else to everyone. From one human being, he created all races of people and made them live throughout the whole earth. He made himself fixed beforehand that exact times and the limits of the places where they would live. Chapter 28? He did this so that they would look for him and perhaps find him as they felt around for him. Yet God is actually not far away from any one of us. As someone has said, in him we live and move and have our being. It is as some of our poets have said, we too are his children.
Mm-hmm. So, if indeed he gave you your very breath, and for those moments of sustaining, he is not putting you in a place of torture or punishment. He's putting you in a place that says, I need you to search for me. I need for you to get to a place where Daddy is source again. Because in him, I move and have my being. Wait a minute. In him, I now have a divine go. But in him, I find my identity. In him, I find my satisfaction. In him, I find my self-worth. In him, I find my strength. In him, I find my power. Wait a minute. How different is that if the Lord has helped me? Wait a minute. It's already done. Because Paul wrote this hundreds of years later. Centuries later. From when David wrote Psalms 118, where he said, the Lord has already helped me. Because in him, I move and have my being. I want you to understand that life ain't life if God can't breathe through you. See, that's a whole nother level. Remember I told you about past, present, and future? In the past, we understood that God breathed in the dirt and it became alive. But the present tense of it is, I'm just trying to get close enough to you, God, where I can even feel your breath. But the future this is, I understand by faith that I will live and not die. So no longer am I, okay, I'm still breathing. I'm no longer checking to see if I'm dead. I'm no longer checking to see if I'm killing myself. Guess what I'm checking for? How can two walk together lest they agree? In him, I move and have my being. In him, he's breathing through me. Now, he's moving through me now. So guess what? Every time he's moving through me, because the life ceases to exist when God stops breathing, I declare over you right now, come alive. Come alive. Come alive. I use that word sustain. And for once in my life, I actually preach from some notes. I'm gonna give you the last note, which is the last definition. Of life. And this blew me away. Because it's everything that I preach on a spiritual level and a physical level. It says the experience existed to transcending physical death. But is an opportunity for continued viability. Viability meaning the capacity or opportunity to operate or be sustained. If indeed I flow, I'm operating. But when I need a buildup, when I need some encouragement, when I need a push, I need to be sustained. When I'm flowing, it's an opportunity for me to operate. But when I'm going through, it's now God's opportunity to sustain. See, the one cool thing about a breath is it's an exchange. You can't breathe without inhaling, but once you inhale, you gotta exhale. You gotta make an exchange. So if indeed I exchange my life for the opportunity to operate in your flow, oh God, God says, guess what? You just exhale, so I'm going to inhale. In him, I have my movement and my being. I got my very existence because guess what? No longer am I waiting on God just to breathe. Guess what? I'm now in time with him. I'm going to stop there. Stop there. Because what we got to understand is we got to start living. God is going to live. And it's a whole lot of things that are trying to kill us off. You look at it long enough, it'll kill every dream you ever had. The music that we listen to, conversations we listen to, ideas and images about ourselves, what we thought we couldn't do, what we thought we wasn't good enough to do. These are all life killers. What had happened was 20 years down the road, life killers. I can read it. I can study it. But if I'm not praying to God to experience Him in it, this means nothing. I know a whole lot of folks have been in church 30, 40, 50 years, but have yet to experience God in His Word. Have yet to see His Word come to life. Uh-oh. I hope you just caught that. His Word come to life. His Word being breathed out of me. Exhale. Wait a minute, because as I'm exhaling His Word, He's inhaling some more into me. Because in Him I live and I breathe. In Him I shall live and not die. In Him I choose life and goodness. I choose life and favor. In Him I have life more abundantly. In Him I got something more than the corner. Because the class clown, when the teacher got tired of him, where did they send him? To the corner. Come out the corner. Come out of the corner. Father, in the name of Jesus, we just bless you today for speaking, for loving, for encouraging, for changing lives. Father, I just pray right now that this seed go deep, that this seed take root, that this seed get watered well. And I pray right now that the practice of life be performed in each and every person's lives that have heard this message today, that hear this message at a future time. Father, I just plant this seed and declare right now that they shall live and not die. That they shall have life and life more abundantly because you sent your son Jesus into the midst. That you sat back and thought enough of us not to forget us when we forgot how to live. Father, I just pray right now that the word become experience in their lives. That they will have great experiences with you. That they will have great manifestations of who you are and what you're doing in their lives. That they will not miss one more experience with you because of a wrong choice. Father, I just pray right now that discernment kick in, that you bring forth a strong discernment right now so that they would be able to see what's good. That they would be able to understand what is evil. That they would be able to pick and choose of you the way that you want us to do it. That they would have an embrace of your fullness. That they would have an embrace of your vision. That they would have an embrace of your feelings. An embrace of your touch. An embrace of your very breath. And that we would learn to get in time. That we would hear your heartbeat. And that we would have an appreciation for every breath and every exchange that we've made with you. Father, just touch right now. Bless their families. Bless their homes. Bless them on their jobs. Grant them favor. Grant them love in places that they never received love before. Father, I just pray right now that the class clown spirit and mentality die right now. We bind that thing up in the name of Jesus. And today we make a choice to not allow that thing back into our house. But there is no excuse to evict that spirit, because guess what, oh God? You have already come in and overflowed the house with your word. They already have an answer, oh God. So in the time of need, we just pray, oh help, that you come in and you sustain them. Give them the words to say in the right time. If they ain't got nothing else to say, oh spirit, just tell them, I shall not die. Give them what they need, oh Jesus. For I declare deliverance in this house. I declare a change in this house today. I declare life in this house today. Come alive, people, right now in the name of Jesus. Spirit man, come alive in the name of Jesus. You shall live and not die. So I pray today, oh God, show us life and life more abundantly. Help us to embrace abundant living. Help us to understand and not be misguided by the things that shall kill, steal, and destroy. Let us not be tricked. Have your way in their hearts. Have your way in their lives. In this week, oh God, show yourself mighty. Give them the experiences necessary to grow, to change, to be an example of life. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.